السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أفضل الخلق أجمعين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah سبحانه وتعالى. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And we ask Allah سبحانه وتعالى to bless his household and all his companions, and to bless all those who struggled and strove through the generations to bring the deen to us. And we ask Allah to bless every single one of us and our offspring and to grant us goodness. Ameen. Ameen. Beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, it is very heartwarming to be in this beautiful place known as Salt Lake. And behind me I see the lakes of salt, mashallah. And we ask Allah to make this masjid a masjid that is definitely utilized, and that we realize the value of this place and that it is the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Port Elizabeth is known as, or used to be known as, the Windy City. Where the wind went, I don't know. Since I've been here the last 2-3 days, there was no wind, subhanallah. What happened? The wind has been blown away, subhanallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us all, to grant us ease and goodness. I'm sure we have heard about Luqman alayhi salatu was salam. Some might argue, why are you saying alayhi salatu was salam when he was not a Nabi of Allah? So that brings us to issue number one. Who was he? May Allah's peace and blessings be upon us all. Allah has named an entire surah, or has named him in an entire surah, and the name of that surah was given as Surah Luqman. There is a debate as to whether he was a prophet or not, with the most correct opinion that he was not a prophet of Allah, but he was a very wise man and a pious saint at the same time. So some of his wisdom is mentioned in the Quran, Surah Luqman. If you open the surah, you will see, Tilka ayatul kitab al-hakim. These are the verses of the book All Wise. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us wisdom. He was a person from Sudan. Did you know that? He was an African from Africa, according to some of the narrations. And yet his name is in the Quran, an entire surah is named after him. An African, a man from Sudan, and some of his advice that he had given his own son, mentioned in the surah as verses of the Quran, the words of Allah. So Allah spoke about him, and we are repeating those verses up to today. Subhanallah. Shows us point number one, racism is non-existent in Islam. Allah created different colors, different sizes, different shapes, different parts of the globe, with people who have different inclinations and so on. And all of us are from Adam, and Adam is from soil, turab. And Allah created Adam. So for someone to think Islam is only for the Arabs, they are wrong. لا فضل لعربي على عجمي ولا لعجمي على عربي ولا لأبيض على أسود ولا لأسود على أبيض إلا بالتقوى. There is no virtue for an Arab over a non-Arab, or a non-Arab over an Arab, or a black over a white, or a white over a black, except by piety. What lies in your heart is what makes you different in the eyes of Allah. So don't think Islam is a religion solely for the Arabs, or solely for the Indians, or solely for the Malay, or solely for any other nationality or group or race. No, it is for all. Not only that, if you read the Quran, you will see, and if you read the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you will see that it has been proven that the virtue is for one who has value in terms of piety. That is the virtue. And the piety is known by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today we love each other for the pleasure of Allah, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we draw lines that were not drawn by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we fail not only as human beings, but as mu'mineen, as muslimin. So this is a very interesting point. A man from Sudan, a nawba, that is the term used, that is roughly that region of Africa. He was an African, and Allah says he was a wise man.
وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا لُقْمَانَ الْحِكْمَةَ أَنِشْكُرْ لِلَّهِ
Allahu Akbar. And remember, we have given Luqman wisdom. So Allah gives wisdom to whomsoever He wishes. No matter who you are and where you come from, there can be wisdom from anywhere across the globe. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to be grateful, to show gratitude to Him when He has bestowed us with something. So that is point number one. The issue that we learn from one another, we benefit from one another, and we do not, and we should not, be thinking that there is superiority of a color or a race above another. Never. Secondly, what did this man say that was so important that Allah makes mention of it in the Quran? So Allah says, remember the advice of Luqman, remember the advice of Luqman.
وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانُ لِبْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعِظُهُ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ.
And remember, when Luqman was advising his son, he said, oh my young son, the word is used, bunayya. Bunayya is the most eloquent term, full of love, that can be used to describe your own son. Which means, he spoke to his son with lots of love. Yet he was giving him a powerful message. How many of us speak to our spouses with love before our own children? If you cannot speak to the mother of your child with love, how are you going to speak to the child of that same mother with love? Look at how Allah says, Ya Bunayya. Remember when Luqman told his son, oh Bunay. Bunay, Ibnun is a son. Bunay means my little son, my cute little sweetie. That's what it is. My cute son, my small boy. However you'd like to word it. Obviously, the wordings change from place to place, depending on how we would call our children. But a beautiful calling. Attract his attention. Show him he is dear to you. That's when he'll listen to you. If you are screaming and yelling at your child, no matter what message you are giving the child will not want to listen. So, oh my son, oh my young son, my little son, subhanallah. First thing you need to know, don't associate partners with your maker, Allah. Allah has created you to worship Him alone. Remember that. Allah made me and you for what? To worship Him alone. Don't get upset when people talk to you about shirk. Don't get angry. Listen to it. They are right. If they are telling you this is shirk and this is wrong, you need to be careful. That message was sent from Allah to you for you to understand what's going on. This advice has been repeated in the Quran. The biggest crime that you could ever commit is shirk. There's no bigger crime than that. Not at all. Shirk is worse than murder and worse than anything else. Subhanallah. May Allah protect us from all crime. But we need to know, if a person, for example, has committed whatever crime he's committed, he engages in tawbah, and sometimes he may arrive in the akhirah with a bit of iman in him, he may be forgiven for some sins that he might not have, or he may have forgotten, or he may have not found the time to seek repentance for. Allah may forgive. But if you've died without repenting from shirk, no hope. Allah says, I am telling you in advance, no hope. Allah says, I will not forgive it. And for the most merciful to say that about something, it's serious. So this is why the first piece of advice, when Allah speaks of the prophets, He says, they advise their people, don't worship anyone but Allah.
وَإِلَىٰ عَادٍ أَخَاهُمْ هُودًا.
We've heard that.
وَإِلَىٰ ثَمُودَ أَخَاهُمْ صَالِحًا. وَإِلَىٰ مَدْيَنَ أَخَاهُمْ شُعَيْبًا. كَذَّبَتْ قَوْمُ لُوطٍ الْمُرْسَلِينَ.
Read every story of every Nabi in the Quran. And immediately Allah says,
قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرُهُ.
They all said the same thing. First things first. Oh my people, worship Allah alone. That you have no deity besides Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't engage in shirkiyat. So this was the advice of Luqman alayhi salam to start with. Oh my young son, remember, don't worship, don't associate partners with Allah. Don't worship things besides Allah or with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah alone.
Inna shirka la dhulmun azeem.
He goes on to say, oh my son, you need to know that associating partnership with Allah is one of the greatest forms of self-oppression and oppressing. You're oppressing yourself. Allah made you. What did we do just now? We read Salatul Maghrib, mashallah. When we put our head on the ground, who did we put it down for? The one who made us. We will never put that head on the ground for anyone but Allah. That's it. No act of worship is allowed to be rendered for anyone besides Allah. Stick or stone, a pious man or this or a saint. You do not put your head on the ground for anyone but Allah. That's it. And you do not render any act of worship for anyone but Allah. You have a scholar visiting you. You do not render an act of worship for him. A'udhu billah. You might respect him. But there is a fine line between respect and worship, which you need to understand and do not cross it. No matter who, he's a human being, he's a creature of Allah. We respect him, we might pray for him, we might draw benefit from him, he may guide us, but he is not Allah. Allah alone is to be worshipped. Inna shirka la dhulmun azim. And immediately after that, Luqman alayhi salam makes mention of parents. Why does he talk about parents straight after that? Who made you? Allah. Who made me? Allah. In order to bring me here, he chose for me parents as a test for me and for them. No matter who they are, Muslim or non-Muslim, they may be sinful or pious, whoever they are, the fact that Allah chose my parents and yours without my interference or application and without yours, it means they are a test for you and for them. How they handle you and how you handle them. No matter where and how they belong in terms of religion, it's a test. We need to understand, even if your parents are Christian, or if they are Buddhists, or if they are atheists, agnostics, or if they were Muslim and they left Islam, Allah protect us all. It's a test. It's a test to see what do you do, and how do you react, and how do you fulfill their rights as bad as they are, or as good as they may be. And the same applies to parents. Allah's given you your children. It's a test for you. How do you bring them up? What are the decisions and choices you make for them at a time when they had no choice? You were the ones who made the decisions for your own children. I've always said, when a child is born, the child does not make its mind up as to what clothing it will wear, what type of nappies, pampers or huggies, or disposable or not. It's your choice. And after that, how you clothe the child, what type of toys you give the child, what type of creche or nursery you're going to send the child to, what type of primary school, then the child has no say. You have the say. As the child grows up, the say becomes less and less and less and less. Allah takes it away. Why does Allah take it away in stages? Because as the child grows up, you should have used your choice in a way that when the child starts using its own choice, it's already learned from you how to use choice. So there comes a stage when you buy your child clothes. Dad, I'm not going to wear that. I don't like it. My son, you've never told me this before. Well, Dad, there's a first for everything. I'm sure you've heard that. And later on, you ask your daughter, for example, I'm going to send you to this school. No, I want to go to the private school. It's a college. I want to go there. But my daughter, no, I'm sorry. Otherwise, I won't go to school. You know how the children are today. I don't want to go. I'm going to go there. I know of cases where Muslim children are picked up from their schools by their parents in what we call a baki. And the child says, Dad, go back and fetch the murk and come and fetch me. How dare you pick me up with this thing in front of all my cronies here? Wallahi, we've come across this. So there comes a time when your child will give you an answer. Before that time, you need to teach your children how and what to question, how to answer, how to live, how to make choices. So Allah has chosen parents. This is why immediately after speaking of worshipping Allah alone, in several places in the Quran, including this advice of Luqman alayhi salatu wassalam, Allah says, He says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ. Allah has advised you regarding your parents. Why? حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ وَهْنًا عَلَىٰ وَهْنٍ. His mother, the mother of man, has carried him with difficulty upon difficulty, pain upon pain. You know, the childbirth is not a joke. If Allah wanted, He could have made it the easiest thing on earth. Do you know that? If Allah wanted, childbirth would have been as good as manufacturing motor vehicles. Simple. It's on a conveyor. As you move and progress, a few months down the line, the thing just starts coming out. Allahu Akbar. Allah chose for it not to be that way. There must be hardship, there must be difficulty for you to understand the value of a human and your value and the sacrifice of your mother and the sacrifice of your parents, and for your parents to value you as a gift that came after great difficulty and hardship. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. So we have our children, we are advised, and we have parents, we are advised, both fronts. What is the advice? Allah says, "Anishkur li wa li walidayka ilayya al-masir." In order for you to be grateful to me, meaning to Allah, and to your parents, Allah wants every one of us to be grateful to his or her parents. Why? They looked after you at a time when, had they forsaken you, you wouldn't have survived. Some people dump their children. Allah protect us. Some of those children die. They did not grow up to see anything. May Allah protect us all. And some people give up their children for adoption for whatever reason. And they did not look after their own children. But whatever the reason is, your biological parents are your biological parents. And the parents who looked after you, they also have their own status and their level. And they have their rights that need to be fulfilled, because they looked after you at a time when, had they left you, nobody would have cared for you. Or perhaps you may have died, or Allah might have chosen someone else, to be honest, to have done that job. So we need to respect our parents. And we need to know how to draw the line and where to draw it. And Allah comes very, very beautifully by making mention here that first is Allah, then is your parents. If Allah wanted, He could have started with the advice, your parents. Then after a while, He would have said, and be careful, you also need to watch your link with Allah. But He started off by saying, watch your link with Allah, and then make sure you know who your parents are and you fulfill their rights. Now someone might say, my father's a bad man, he's not a Muslim. My mother, this happened to her, she's not a Muslim. Or I accepted Islam later. These people are drunkards, they're not pious. These people are like this. My mother dumped me when I was young. Now I've grown older and I'm seeing who she is. What should I do? And so on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you one piece of advice through the advice of Luqman alayhi salam. What a wise man. Luqman the wise. Like I said, the term alayhi salam is normally used for prophets. But here we use it for Allah's blessings to be upon us and upon him as well. Pious man. Wise man. So Allah says, وَإِن جَاهَدَاكَ عَلَىٰ أَن تُشْرِكَ بِمَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ فَلَا تُطِعْهُمَا. If your parents are telling you to do something that is against the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then do not follow them. If it involves polytheism, and if it involves associating partners with Allah, and if it involves sin, do not listen to them. Do not obey them in that. So if your father tells you, you know what, here is the fire. As a Buddhist, I'm instructing you to light this fire and to take it into the temple. And I'd like you to say your prayers there. You say, Dad, that's where I draw the line. I'm not going to do this. It negates the faith that I have in my Rabb, the one who made me. I won't worship a stick or a stone or an idol. No, I won't do that. But do you have to become bad to your parents? So immediately Allah says, وَصَاحِبُهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا. Live with them, accompany them. صَاحِبُهُمَا means accompany them with goodness in this world, even though they may be bad. When they've instructed you to do something wrong, you do not listen to that wrong. But you continue fulfilling their rights. You might still clothe your father. You might feed him. You might give him something depending on his age. You might push his wheelchair, but he's not a Muslim. You might help him do this or do that. When he tells you to do something haram, there you draw a line. You put a full stop. You say, I'm not going to do this. And you know what? I will still be kind to you. I will not swear you. I will respect you. I will not abuse you, and so on. The same applies to your mother. You cannot abuse, you cannot swear, you cannot shout. Wallahi, if you shout at your mother, swear her, abuse her, go and ask her for forgiveness. There will come a time when you will pay heavily for that. Very heavily. Watch out, be careful. I always tell the youngsters, you know, when you're young, you say things. As you grow older, you realize, if Allah gave you age, you are lucky. Go back to your mom, say, "Mom, I'm so sorry, I might have sworn you, I abused you, I told you things, I made you cry, I'm very, very sorry, I don't want to pay back one day." In a way that you won't really realize sometimes that this is a payment for me disrespecting my mother. Your mother will still have a big heart and say, "My son, don't worry, I already told Allah, Ya Allah, my child has disrespected me, but don't punish him, I forgive him." That's the condition of the heart of the mother. May Allah not make us mothers who curse our children, because that is the opposite. Some mothers, a poor child came home with bad results from school. "You pig, you dog, astaghfirullah." How can we use those type of words for our children? Wallahi, it's happening in society. People call their children dogs, and they call them names, and they curse them. And you are the mother, how can you say that? One child complained to me that my mother calls me a dog. I said, "Well, you know what that makes her? Go and ask her. Allah protect us." Really? So we need to think. What do we say? So at the same time that we are expecting our children to respect us, we always say, make it easy for them to respect you. You want your child to respect you, but my mother, you are in the clubs. You are a person doing this. You have a nightlife. You have whatever else. And you want your child to come and say, "How are you, ma? Kiss your hands," and so on. "Kiss you on your forehead," and what have you. Subhanallah, the child is watching. The child knows this mother is up to nonsense. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us children who are obedient. But remember, obedience against the obedience of Allah is non-existent. It's null and void. If a creature of Allah is instructing you to do something against the creator of Allah, you don't follow it. You come out of it with respect. No need to sway. No need to scream and yell. Come out of it with respect. You can even guide them, "Mom, I think you are wrong. And what you are doing is in the transgression of Allah. But I am not going to be a part of this." Subhanallah. May Allah protect us. So Luqman alayhi salam, the verses continue. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of the fact that we should follow the path of those who have turned to Allah always. Why? Because you are going to return to Allah. وَاتَّبِعْ سَبِيلَ مَنْ أَنَابَ إِلَيَّ ثُمَّ إِلَيَّ مَرْجِعُكُمْ فَأُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. Follow the path of those who have turned to Allah. Those who have turned to me, Allah says, follow their path. Look at them. See them. Allahu Akbar. You know, Ibrahim alayhi salam, one of the names used to refer to him in the Quran, Munib. Munib is someone who turns to Allah, constantly turning to Allah. May Allah make us Munib also, those who turn to Allah. So Allah says, وَاتَّبِعْ سَبِيلَ مَنْ أَنَابَ إِلَيْهِ. Follow the path of the one or those who have turned to me, Allah says. May Allah make it easy for us to follow the paths of the Anbiya alayhimus salatu wassalam. Because Allah says, then you will come to me and I will inform you of what you used to do. Or I will judge between you regarding whatever happened. There might be certain things you may not be able to solve here. Your parent is still upset with you. Why didn't you come to the club to me? Why didn't you buy that alcohol and bring it? That beer that I sent you to buy from Spa, you didn't bring it along. I'm upset with you. Allah will curse you. Remember, those curses are not valid. A curse is only valid if you deserve it. If you don't deserve it, just smile at them. That curse is not valid. Some people get worried. My father cursed me. Why? Because I didn't give a lift to his girlfriend. It's happening. This is a real life example. Well, that curse is not valid. In fact, what you did was a good deed. Subhanallah. You did not support him. One day, he will appreciate what you did for him. One day, he will realize and he will understand. Subhanallah. So this is why Allah says, follow the path of those who turn to me. And remember, you're going to come to me and I will judge between you. And I will let you know what the reality was. Then the piece of advice is so beautiful. Something worth crying about. You see, we do deeds sometimes that we are not proud about. Sins that we've committed. Would you commit a sin openly in public? The answer is most probably no. What would you do? You'd hide. Make sure no one is watching. Whether it is No matter what, you make sure no one is watching, you try to hide, duck and dive. So Luqman is telling his son, and Allah makes mention of it, that, oh my son, listen to the advice.
يَا بُنَيَّ إِنَّهَا إِن تَكُ مِثْقَالَ حَبَّةٍ مِّنْ خَرْدَلٍ.
Oh my son, I want you to know one thing. Even if it is the weight of a mustard seed, the weight of a mustard seed. What about the weight of a mustard seed? He says,
فَتَكُنْ فِي صَخْرَةٍ.
If that amount of anything is inside a rock, not on the rock, not under the rock, inside the rock, Allah will bring it forth. That small atom's weight, worth of a deed or an item or anything inside a rock, Allah will bring it forth. And he continues to say,
أو في السماوات أو في الأرض يأتي بها الله.
Whether it is in the skies, the heavens, or the earth, Allah will bring it forth. So don't think you are going to hide from Allah. There is nowhere to hide, not at all. Some people hide behind the walls in order to commit a sin. Those walls are actually bearing witness against you. CCTV in the walls. It's a reality. Today when people want to pinch from a supermarket, Allah protect us and our offspring and our businesses. What do? They look where all the CCTVs are and they know this aisle, at this angle, they're not going to see me. So they pick up something and walk to that spot. Then they shove it somewhere in their bodies and walk out. No. A CCTV is something minor and we are scared of it. What about Allah? Allah says, entire creation will bear witness for you or against you. Never mind entire creation. Your own limbs, the organ you used to sin, will bear witness against you. Your hands, your legs, your private parts, whatever it was that you used in order to sin, that very organ will get up and say, yes, this is what he did. Allahu Akbar. Now what are you going to do? And this is in the Quran, in more than one place. In Surah An-Nur, Allah says,
يَوْمَ تَشْهَدُ عَلَيْهِمْ أَلْسِنَتُهُمْ وَأَيْدِيهِمْ وَأَرْجُلُهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ.
On that day, their tongues will bear witness. You are quiet, but your tongue begins to talk. The tongue has another tongue which starts speaking. And the legs begin to speak. And the hands begin to speak as to what they used to do. In Surah Yasin, there is another verse in that regard as well. We ask Allah to safeguard us. Remember one thing, and I always say, there is hope. Sometimes we sit, and you know it brings tears to our eyes when we have done things we are not proud of. Or when there is a lesson, remember, you can delete it all through tawbah, turning to Allah. You can delete it, wipe it out. We are so lucky we are alive. We are sitting here. We are listening to a reminder. Fortunate. Just press delete, gone. And when you ask Allah to forgive you, you need to say, Ya Allah, what I did was wrong. I admit it. I regret it. And I'm not going to do it again. Those are the four conditions. But the minute you say, hey, I might do it again, that's a problem. That tawbah is not clean. It's not clear. Don't say, I might do it again. You know, I admit it. I regret it. I apologize for it. But hey, doing it again, I don't know. If that's the case, you still haven't learned a lesson. You haven't yet purified your soul. You haven't had enough in life sometimes in terms of negativity to bring you back. And maybe you're waiting for it. Because we should not be waiting for negativity. Sometimes we are not prepared to give up a sin. Why? Hey, she's the most beautiful woman in this world. But then marry her. Come on. Allahu Akbar. Allah protect us. Allah has given you a way out. We always say, the more difficult we make it for our children to get married, the easier we make it for them to fornicate, so we are guilty. Remember that. It's like a seesaw. You make one thing hard, the other thing becomes easy. You make one thing easy, the other thing becomes hard. When we make marriage easy for our children, we make it impossible for them to fornicate. Or at least we fulfilled our duty, we make it tough for them. They cannot use us as an excuse. But sometimes they might say, Ya Allah, what I've done is a sin, but I was put into a corner. I had no other option. Allahu Akbar. May that not happen to us. Because they will be to blame, but we share part of the blame. We made it tough for them. May Allah make it easy for us and our offspring. The same applies to us. Sometimes a person tells you, you know what? My daughter's too young. She's still studying. They're already committing zina every day at that varsity. What do you know? What do you know? It's a fact of life. You haven't even smelt the coffee yet. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. I've pressed a red button because we know the reality on the ground. The varsities are becoming worse and worse to the degree that children are going there and becoming gays and lesbians. That's what's happening sometimes. I'm not saying it's a bad place or a good place. It's like town or anywhere else. It depends who you want to mix with, even in society. Your child can be messed without going to varsity. And your child can become pious at the varsity. So there is no rule to say this happens, your child is going to succeed. That happens, your child is going to fail. There's no rule of that nature. But you need to follow Allah's rule for the success to come by the will of Allah. And if some form of failure is there, at least you will not be blamed. Allahu Akbar. So this is why we say those who are busy saying, Subhanallah, my child is still at school, still after 4 or 5 years we'll see. Are you waiting for a premarital pregnancy before you wake up? Some people, wallahi, I'm telling you, this is going to be a red button. I'm here in Salt Lake, but Allah forgive us. It's a reality. Some people, the children actually say, you know what? If your father or your mother is being an obstacle, what you do? Just get pregnant and you'll see they'll have to nod their heads and agree whether they like it or not. Wallahi, I have heard the statement more than 30 times without a joke from different people. And then we start thinking, but when do we get a chance to advise these parents? When do we get a chance to talk to them? They don't want to admit it won't happen. Not my daughter, not my son. Hang on. There is no patent to say it cannot happen to you. No ways. This type of thing knows no age. And it is disastrous. It can attack even the most pious of people in their homes. May Allah safeguard us, protect us. This is why I understand this advice. Luqman alayhi salatu wassalam, we were speaking about how he says to his son, oh my son, no matter what it is you've done, even if it is inside a rock, Allah will bring it out. And he'll say, here it is. That's the power of Allah. Allah knows everything. He knows what is hidden from you and me completely. يَعْلَمُ خَائِنَةَ الْأَعْيُنِ وَمَا تُخْفِي الصُّدُورِ. He knows the deception in the eye and what is in the heart. Some people look at you, innocent look, but the man is about to murder you. Allahu Akbar. As innocent as he may look, if he is a murderer and if he is intending to rob you and harm you, who will protect you? You don't know, because he's been given an innocent look. But if you make dua, Ya Allah, protect me from those who are intending to harm me, Allah will give you a feeling in your heart. You know what? Don't deal with this man. He's about to rob you. So you don't deal with him. It happens sometimes in business where you'd like to do a deal and something somehow says to you, you know what? Don't deal with this man. Leave him alone. No matter how crucial the deal is. And you step back and then you hear that he robbed someone else. And you thank Allah, Ya Allah, I thank you so much. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. May He help us, really. And may He help us distinguish between right and wrong. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says here, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَطِيفٌ خَبِيرٌ. Allah knows everything and He is very, very intricate. When it comes to little items, He knows, He controls them, He looks after them, and He has total control over every aspect of existence, even the minutest of item. Allah knows about it and is in control of it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. Now look at how Luqman is mentioning these points to his son. He started off by speaking about shirk. Then he speaks about parents. Then he says, don't sin. And remember, Allah knows everything. Allah is the Allamul Ghuyub. Allah is the one who knows. And after that he says, oh my son, fulfill your duty unto Allah by establishing your salah. Ya bunayya aqimi salata. In that sharia, the salah might have been different. But still, whatever that act of worship was that was compulsory for them. He says, oh my son, fulfill this act of worship. Fulfill your salah. Establish your salah. Let's be brutally honest. How many parents don't read their salah? What are you going to tell your son? How many parents do not read Fajr? What are you going to tell your daughter? You are a proper parent. You want to understand the gift of Allah upon you. If your child is dear to you, if you want to be with your children in paradise, and you want goodness for your children, and you really love them, tell them to fulfill salah, and you start off leading by example, fulfilling that salah. That is called real love. One day they'll pick it up. When you grow old, I'm sure a lot of us, we realize, my father used to get me up for Salatul Fajr. I can tell you my own example. My father used to sit right by my bed, and he did not used to move until I got up. Without a joke, I know it. I do not do that with my own son because we are weaker. We get them up. Yes, we try our best to bring them out. But after a while, you've got to go for your own salah, you're gone. My father did not move. He would start very early. He would read his sunnah next to my bed. Without a joke, I'm telling you my own story. And he would not move until I get off that bed. And I would feel so guilty because he would say, if you do not get up now, even I am going to have to miss, meaning I may miss this salah. Obviously he did not miss it, but just threatening me or telling me, trying to get me to get up in a nice way. Today we sit and look back at that generation and we say, Ya Allah, where are we? Where were they? We are not prepared to sacrifice half the sacrifice that our parents sacrificed upon us in order to bring up our own children sometimes. May Allah strengthen us and make us strong. Allahu Akbar. So this is Luqman. Imagine what type of advice this must have been that Allah Himself spoke about it. And it's revealed and it is recited until eternity. The Quran will exist forever. Luqman, a man from Sudan, a man from Africa. And here's his advice. Oh my son, establish your salah. Aqim as-salah. And if you establish your salah, you need to know other things. وَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَانْهَا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. You need to enjoin that which is good. Encourage people to do good. Instruct people to do good. Luqman himself spoke to his son in the most loving, most respectful way. Is there any disrespect here? No disrespect. He spoke so lovingly and he respected his child. If you want your child to listen to you, you need these two qualities. Respect your child. To respect your child, you have to respect yourself to start with. You respect yourself. You know, there are people who smoke. Allah protect us all and help us give up this bad habit. People who smoke. Hats off to those who may realize that even though I know this is a bad habit, I don't want to do it in front of my children. They must not know I'm a smoker. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, a bad habit a man has, he wants to give it up. But the blessing of all of that is that he realizes that if my son sees me smoking, he may start taking to this habit lightly. How many of us would think that if we had this bad habit, let's make sure our children don't even know about it. May Allah forgive us. Wallahi, it's tough. Today people have open bad habits. Like I said, you tell your own son, hey, you know what, just drop me at the casino. What are you talking about? What are you talking about? This happens. The father says, no, come join me, I'll show you how to do it. Allahu Akbar. You're showing me how to gamble? He says, no, you're a sharp youngster, you might earn a little bit here and there. You know? It's a game of chance. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. So it's important to know the stages. You do not sin, number one. But if you have a bad habit and you know this is a bad habit, you need to make sure, at least do not let it pass on to another generation. If it is done in private, there is a greater chance sometimes of the mercy of Allah coming forth. May Allah forgive us, really. And may He open our doors. Obviously, I've just mentioned the issue of smoking. But there are many other issues. It's just by way of example. So he tells his son, enjoin that which is correct. Instruct people to do good. U'mur bil ma'ruf. Instruct with goodness. Tell people to do good. wanha anil munkar, and remind them to abstain from bad. Prohibit the evil, as we would word it. Do good and prohibit bad. Some people, they tell people to do good and only to do good, but they forget to remind them, look my brother, what you are doing is wrong. We are too shy sometimes. But you know what? That person might come out of a ditch that they've been in for the last 2 years or 5 years just by you telling them, brother, what you're doing is wrong. And we are not judgmental. My brothers and sisters, when someone tells you, sister, you know you are uncovered, don't do that. Come on. Allah's blessed you with so much goodness and so on. And you say, why are you judging me? That's a common statement. It's dangerous. We are not judging you. We are advising you with goodness. Allah will judge you. Nobody said, my sister, you're a bad woman. That is now called judging. We didn't say you're a bad woman, but your habit is definitely bad. We're not judging you, but we know about your habit. I mean, a man with a bottle, and then he says, stop judging me. Your bottle is judging you. Allahu Akbar. Your bottle has already judged you. May Allah protect us all. So this is why it's important for us to know, enjoying that which is good, encourage people in a nice way, as though you are one of them, because you are. You may have other bad habits that they do not know about. So don't pretend like I'm a big sheikh and I've come here and I'm the holy saint who has no sin at all, and I have to tell all these people, you guys are sinful and you guys are so bad and you need to actually all give up your bad habits because I'm the clean guy and you guys are all dirty people. If that's the case, you are not fulfilling your duty as a Muslim. That is now being judgmental. That is what it is. You think others are bad and you are the only one who's good? No ways. You might have a deed in private through which you may go to hell. And they might have a deed in private through which they may go to heaven. And I want to stop there for a moment. My brothers and sisters, word of encouragement. Every one of us, no matter who you are, develop a secret deed of goodness between you and Allah. Think of this very carefully. Your secret between you and Allah, no one knows it. Maybe every day you gave a small charity to someone. Maybe you said a good word. You might have read some Quran on a daily basis. Some secret private deed between you and Allah that you are so happy about and that you continue doing against all odds. And you say, Ya Allah, this is only for your sake. Try and develop that, inshallah. It's something that will really help you spiritually and it will benefit you immensely and intensely. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our deeds and may He make us do good deeds. And may He make us do deeds that inshallah will result in our entry into paradise. Because remember, it's these little deeds that sometimes may result in us entering into paradise. Now when you tell people to do good, and when you're prohibiting them from bad, you may suffer the consequences of their words. They may say, this man is this. They will label you with whatever labels. They will tell you this. They will tell people not to listen. They will tell this. That's what they did to the messengers. They called him a madman. They called him a magician. They called him possessed. They said he does magic on other people who listen to him. They gave him every title that was in the bad book. But Allah says, "Wasbir ala ma asabak." Be patient regarding that which got to you. And patience here is connected to taqdeer, which is destiny. If you lost your child, if you suffered calamity, if you suffered loss in business, if you suffered any form of loss in this dunya, for as long as you played your role, then the loss came, say, Ya Allah, I surrender to you. You are the owner of taqdeer. You are the one who decrees. I'm not going to fight with you. Ya Allah, I love you. Even though I might have lost 3 of my children all at one go. Allah, may Allah safeguard us. Wallahi, that's your paradise. So Allah says, be patient regarding that which got to you. One of it is to be patient when calamity strikes, or when a test comes in your direction. And the other is to be patient when people make your life difficult. Because when you instruct people, brothers, let's go for salah, I tell you, who you think you are? Today the youngsters will say, huh, this guy thinks he's a pope. Even the pope resigned. Allah protect us. This guy thinks he's a pope. Allah protect us. Even the pope resigned. These are the type of answers our children give us today. Just be patient. You don't have to swear back. You don't have to retaliate in a wrong way. Immediately, you know, you make a dua for them. They are your children or whoever else it is. And you say, Ya Allah, guide them. Learn from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In Ta'if, he says, Allahumma hadi qawmi fa innahum la ya'lamun. Oh Allah, guide my people. They don't know. They don't know who they're talking to here. They don't realize and understand who I am and who you have sent to them. It's a fact. Nabi of Allah, he knew he's a messenger. Jibreel came to him, the angels came to him. Oh Allah, they don't even know that the angels of the mountains had come to me and I could have crushed them with one statement. They don't even know that. So Ya Allah, guide them. Subhanallah. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. I was sitting one day and thinking of the people of Ta'if, because it is one of the most touching stories in the seerah. And I told myself, just a thought, to say, you know, those people, had they known, the Prophet says, oh Allah, forgive them, they don't know. Had they known, firstly, they would have said, he's a madman, he's a magician. Imagine if he told them, do you know, the angels of these two mountains came to me and told me that one instruction and I can crush you. Imagine if he told them, just for a moment, think about it. What would they have said? Probably they would have said, you are mad. This guy is insane, he needs help. Then what happens? Imagine another thing, if he did instruct those angels and then the mountain started moving, they would look at him, look at the mountain. Look at him, look at the mountain. That's what I was picturing. And I'm thinking now with Nuh alayhi salatu wassalam, subhanallah, you must be thinking this man thinks a lot. But sometimes you need to look at what happened to the messengers. What were the answers their people gave them? And how merciful they were that they did not call on that card that they had. They didn't play the card, so to speak. He had a card, definitely, in our language. He didn't play it. Because he knew, no, let them have the day. Let's hope that from their progeny, they will be mu'mineen. Wallahi, from their progeny, they were Muslims. Imagine them looking at the mount coming. Some of them might accept and others will be like the time of Nuh with his own son. His father told him, hey, the water is coming. He says, don't worry, dad, I'm a swimmer. I can swim. Wallahi, here in PE, sometimes when the wind is there and the waves are massive waves, even a professional will tell you, hey, stop surfing. This place is not for surfing. Not now. Wait for it to calm down a little bit. And others might say, no man, I'm a pro man. You know what? This is when you can surf even better, because these are huge waves. Some of them have lost their lives. Do you agree? Yes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us wisdom and understanding. The example I'm giving is that of the fact that Allah gives me and you a chance. He doesn't just destroy you. He gives you a chance to turn. May Allah grant us the ability to utilize the chances as they come. So when you speak to people, you might face the consequences of that. Bear patience. Don't worry. Isbir ala ma asabak is a broad statement. Be patient regarding that which got to you. It's a very broad statement. And it's very, very beneficial for all of us. Because every one of us, calamity strikes. Sometimes things happen. People make our lives difficult. Sometimes family members make our lives difficult. Sometimes strangers make our lives difficult. Allahu Akbar. Allah bless us. And Allah make our lives easy. He is the owner of ease. Then listen to the next piece of advice. So he spoke about salah. And he spoke about enjoining that which is good, prohibiting that which is evil, and about bearing patience. Then he says,
وَلَا تُصَعِّرْ خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَمْشِ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ كُلَّ مُخْتَالٍ فَخُورٍ.
Amazing. Before I translate that, let me tell you what has happened so far. First, he speaks about your link with Allah. Then he speaks about your link with your parents. Then he speaks about the fact that you won't be able to hide anything from Allah. Then he speaks about salah and encouraging good, discouraging bad, and bearing patience. Now this is all the link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This verse that we've just heard is speaking about your link with the rest of human beings. Imagine how holistic this advice is. How beautiful it is. What does he say? وَلَا تُصَعِّرْ خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ. Don't turn your cheek. Don't give that cheek to the people. What that means is, don't be arrogant. Be humble. No matter who you are, be humble, be calm. Luqman the wise, whether the people of his city or village acknowledged him, whether he was known or not, we don't know. Whether they loved him or hated him, we don't know. But what we do know, Allah loved him. What we do know, Allah mentioned him. Subhanallah. This is why, my brothers and sisters, I can tell you something hair-raising. When you do good, Allah mentions you by name to the angels. When we are sitting in a gathering like this, we are mentioned by name to the angels. Wallahi, it's in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You mention Allah, Allah says, I mention you. And who do I mention you to? I mention you to creatures better than you. Or better than those whom you mentioned me to. So if I am talking, for example, to you about Allah, Allah is mentioning all of us to the angels. The angels are a totally different creation of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Amazing. Look at Yunus alayhi salam. Something very, very touching. One of the narrations make mention of how he was swallowed by the whale. And then Allah says, فَلَوْلَا أَنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُسَبِّحِينَ لَلَبِثَ فِي بَطْنِهِ إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. Had he not been from amongst those who always praised us, he probably would have stayed in the belly of the whale forever. What does this mean? Because he used to praise us often every other day or every day before that, the day he was in the whale, we remembered him. And this is why the narrations make mention of the point that is very, very heartwarming, and that is when he made a dua from the darkness of the deep oceans, including the darkness of the belly of the whale, the angels recognize this voice. This is a man, every day this voice calls out in the praise of Allah. Today the voice is calling from a different place, and it is calling a call of distress, and it is saying that I am the one who's wronged myself. And Allah says, yes, that is Yunus. We will save him. Subhanallah. In no time he was saved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Within the matter of a few hours, perhaps 72 hours, perhaps there is a difference of opinion as to exactly how many hours or how many days. But the point being raised is, he was saved by Allah. He called out to Allah. Not for the first time in his life, but every day he used to praise Allah. One day, he is praising Allah and calling out to Allah, Ya Allah, help me. So Allah says, if you get close to me during your days of ease, when you have a day of hardship, I will come to create ease for you. How many of us are ready? So this is why Luqman tells his son, don't be arrogant, be humble, be calm. I always say, you know, we have a weakness. When you get a lot, sometimes you start becoming arrogant. The winner is he who, the more he gets, the more humble he becomes. People don't even know who this is and what's happening. And they don't even realize sometimes, you know, this man, perhaps he owns half of town, but the man is sitting here in your midst, quiet, humbles. May Allah accept it from us. Or, you know this man, he is the Imam of the Haram in Mecca. People say, can't be, man, can't be. Say, wallahi, he is, if they tell you that. And then you look and you say, okay, let's try. We greet him. We greet the man. He greets you as though he's a nobody. That's the winner. That is the man. Why? He is humble, yet he has got so much from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the worst person is he who is arrogant when he's got absolutely nothing. Nil. The hadith actually makes mention of an arrogant beggar. You give a man some coins. He says, what are these coins? Throw them out. I need the notes. I want the notes. I don't know if it happens here, but back in Zimbabwe it happens. You give a man some coins, you throw them straight out. You say, hey, keep that, man. Give me the note. Allah protect us. If that arrogance, wallahi, if you have a little bit and you thank Allah, someone gives you a few coins, say, thank you very much. They might think of giving you a little bit more. It's a fact. Because then they'll think, hey, this man thanked me as though I gave him 50 rands, yet I only gave him 5 cents. So then you take out at least 20 rands. And he says, wow. So those who are sharp, they know it works. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and grant us ease. Do not be arrogant. And don't walk with arrogance and pride on earth. What a beautiful piece of advice. When you walk with arrogance, your life in this world becomes difficult. You know why? People hate you. They don't like you. And if they greet you, they're only greeting you because they know temporarily they might need something from you. That's why they're greeting you. Like for example, you have someone who is in the top position of authority. If he is an arrogant man, people greet him only because tomorrow when I have my application, this guy's signature needs to be on it. That's the only reason they're greeting you. The minute you fired from your post, they won't want to know you at all. On the other hand, you have a top level person who's very humble, and people love him because of his humility. The day he resigns from his job, they will even greet him more, and they will be more respectful because they know this man here, when he was in power, he really served the community so much. They have utmost respect for him. Look at the opposites. May Allah grant us an understanding. So if you are told not to tread the earth with arrogance and pride, so what is the solution? So Luqman makes mention of it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it in the Quran. وَلَا تَمْشِ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ كُلَّ مُخْتَالٍ فَخُورٍ وَقْصِدْ فِي مَشْيِكَ وَاغْضُضْ مِنْ صَوْتِكَ إِنَّ أَنْكَرَ الْأَصْوَاتِ لَصَوْتُ الْحَمِيرِ. You need to know Allah does not like those who are haughty and proud. Allah does not like them. So what should you do? You should walk with humbleness and humility on earth. Walk with humbleness, humility on earth, and speak with the proper, correct voice. You don't need to scream and shout at people, yell at them, swear and abuse. No. Respect yourself. Speak properly. Use the correct volume. Subhanallah. Drop your tone. Speak humbly. Make sure that you've understood the people, and you talk to them in a way that they realize that this man is genuine. He really wants our goodness. Speak to them with humbleness, humility, proper volume. And he ends off, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends the words of Luqman alayhi salatu wasalam by saying, the worst sound is that of a braying ass, a donkey. Worst sound. Why? You don't know what it's saying. Are you hungry? Are you tired? But you've just slept. But you've just ate. The same sound. When you've eaten, the same sound. When you haven't eaten, the same sound. When you are hungry, same sound. When you are tired, the same sound. When you want to move, the same sound. Why? Because no one understands the difference. It's just a braying of a donkey. Sometimes with some people, that is their life. Allah protect us. You give them, they're still ungrateful. You don't give them, they're still ungrateful. You do for them, they're still ungrateful. You don't do for them, they're still ungrateful. No matter what you do or what you don't do, it's still the same. For them, they just abuse, they use bad language, and that's their life, the order of the day. Is that what the gangster culture of today is training us to do? Is that what the people consider the in thing? Every other word is a swear word. Let's change it. We are Muslimin. We want mercy of Allah. I want the mercy. You want the mercy of Allah. How can I attain mercy when I'm not merciful to my own voice box and tongue? I'm not merciful. I'm sending it and blasting it with so many swear words every day. And today, wallahi, it's so terrible that across the globe, they are promoting a culture of I don't give a damn attitude. Every other word is a swear word, a big, big swear word. When we were young, we didn't even know some of these swear words. Now they have come up with a huge swear word. When they want to ask you, how are you? They add a swear word in the middle and then they say it. And when the man is saying, I'm very well, he doesn't say that. He says, he adds a swear word. You can use your imagination. He adds a big swear word to say, I'm fine. We are taught to say, Alhamdulillah. And this person is swearing huge. A swear word that when we were young, if you uttered it, they would probably have a clap across your face. And today, they are saying it, how are you and I am fine, and they peppered with these words. This is the braying of a donkey. Believe me, we better be careful of this. May Allah grant us self-respect. Amen. These are some of the words of advice of Luqman, the wise. This is why Allah calls him the wise, because whatever he has uttered, wallahi, it is something powerful. If it was not powerful and if it was not valid, it would not have been in the Quran. And as I started, I end by saying, look at this, no matter who the man was, no matter where he came from, no matter what his color was, the fact that he spoke something solid, And the fact that he really had a genuine feeling, he respected his child, he spoke with so much love, and his advice was priceless. Allah makes mention of it in the Quran. Today, it is an act of worship. Every letter we read from that advice of Luqman in the Quran, you are getting 10 rewards for it, because it is part of the Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors, and inshallah we hope and pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mercy on all of us. Until we meet again, wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad, subhanallahi bihamdih, subhanakallahumma bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.